Houseplants and aquatic plants are my favorites, and seeing them together is a unique experience for me. On the other hand, aquatic life, with its diverse forms, is truly mesmerizing. Moving this tiny world between my hands makes me feel truly alive. And this video series will follow the entire process from setting up the environment. For this project, I will mainly use one fishbowl to orchids, organic garden soil, river sand, and wood. Additionally, I will use non-toxic adhesive and cotton. I will explain all of this step by step. First, I want to show you my current setup. The perfect combination of makeshift studio lighting. If you tuffed I was making my videos with a perfect setup, here's what it really looks like to work behind the scenes with me. Anyway, let's get back to our main topic. Many orchids are epiphytes, meaning they grow on trees rather than in the soil. They use their roots to cling to branches and absorb moisture and nutrients from the air and rain. In rainforests, they take advantage of indirect sunlight filtered through the tree canopy. Thanks to their high adaptability, they can survive in a variety of habitats, from humid forests to dry mountain slopes. I have used many terrestrial plants in aquariums before and received positive results. In my country, we call this wood flame wood. I could have used driftwood instead, but since flame wood has a curved shape, it's easier to wrap the orchid around it. That's why I chose flame wood. After a lot of effort to shape them the way I wanted, it was time to secure them. Normally, when doing this, I would secure the wood to a stone piece. However, since this bowl is already small, I didn't want to take up more space by adding stones. So, I will directly secure the wood to the glass of the bowl. I place cotton between the wood and the glass to ensure a stronger bond. After successfully passing the safety test, I can move on to the next step with peace of mind. I have some soil here. I collected it from my own garden, where I'm certain no pesticides or fertilizers have been used. I carefully sifted the soil, resulting in a texture as soft as cotton. I use this soil in almost all of my setups. Everything my planted tanks need is present in this soil, and it's completely natural. After putting some soil at the bottom, my cat, who gets impatient to use the bathroom every time she sees soil, enters the scene. I moisten the soil a bit to remove the air pockets inside. The river sand I got from a hardware store is quite dirty, so after rinsing it a bit, I add a thick layer on top of the soil to completely cover it. It's very important to completely cover the soil, because after adding water to the bowl, the soil shouldn't disperse into the water. I'm not adding a technological filter to this tiny world. Instead, an orchid and aquatic plants will serve as the filter. I'm trying to position the orchid so that only its roots remain in the water. The stem, leaves, and flowers will stay just above the water surface, allowing the orchid to get the moisture it needs from the water pool right below. The orchid's roots will absorb waste from the water, taking in nutrients for itself while providing a cleaner living environment for the creatures in the water. In this system, everyone wins. Finally, the first drop of water met the small world. As with my other tanks, I use tap water that has had the chlorine removed. The water, which is a bit cloudy on the first day, looks clearer the next day. In my largest filterless ecosystem, a monstera has been living for over a year. Its roots are completely submerged in the water and play a crucial role in keeping the tank clean. In the water, there are various aquatic plants. One of my favorites, the red-colored rotala, continues to grow in the tank and soon it will emerge above the water, taking on a different form. I'm borrowing some Rotala from my main tank. I think the striking red aquatic plant will complement the orchid's perfect color beautifully. If you're wondering how aquatic creatures breathe, I'll explain right away. Aquatic plants provide oxygen to the water through a process called photosynthesis. During the day, they use sunlight to convert carbon dioxide and water into glucose and oxygen. This oxygen is then released into the water through small openings on their leaves called stomata. As a result, the dissolved oxygen levels in the water increase, which is essential for fish and other aquatic organisms to breathe. To add a touch of green to the bowl, I plant Vallisneria at the front and place some Java moss, which shrimps love, into a cavity in the wood. Of course, plants need light, and in a home environment, LED lights are an excellent alternative to sunlight for aquarists. I have a small LED that will be sufficient for this bowl. After a week, everything looks good. The aquatic plants are healthy, and the orchid is fine. There is a slight yellowing of the water due to the wood, and that's completely natural. Branches in the water can impart some color thanks to the tannins they contain. These tannins are organic compounds naturally found in branches, and when released into the water, they can create a slight yellowing or tea-colored hue. Since everything is going well, I can move the cherry shrimp I ordered to their new home. When I opened the package, I saw that the live creatures were not cherry shrimp, and I didn't want to return them. Because they've already traveled a long way, and they might not survive another journey. When I looked more closely, I was met with another surprise. There were fish fry along with the shrimp. Although I'm not sure, they look like guppy fry. I don't have a ready tank for them at the moment, so they'll be guests in the bowl with the shrimp for a while. After acclimating the creatures to their new water, I place them in their new home. The next day, the bowl, which is a candidate for an ecosystem, woke up to a colorful morning. I want to leave you alone with this atmosphere. As always, thank you for watching the video. See you in the next update.